Let's return to This Week in America. Here's your host, Rick Bratton.
Welcome back, everybody. Coast to Coast, This Week in America. The genesis of the book, it's been a pretty good ride, came from author Bob Harshbarger's three daughters. They've been subjected to numerous tales over the years about where the Harshbargers came from. Countless stories, mostly humorous, about their father growing up in a wheelchair. Well, Bob's children encouraged him to write down some of these accounts along with some genealogical history, and the book began. Bob is a 73-year-old husband and dad who in 1948 was hit with polio at the age of 14 months. Initially totally paralyzed, he's not walked since, confined to a wheelchair. He says it's been a terrific life, thanks to many blessings from God. He grew up on a farm in Illinois, twice married, four children, master's degree in social work, worked 31 years in that capacity at the Veterans Administration Medical Center, worked 12 years as a radio DJ, including emceeing shows for country stars, retired now, living with his wife, Beverly, in Virginia. Bob Harshbarger, author of It's Been a Pretty Good Ride, with us on This Week in America. Bob, welcome to the program. It's great to have you with us.
Hey, Rick, thanks for having me.
What a pleasure, and it's been a pretty good ride and continues to be a pretty good ride. You are enjoying life, and you've got so much going on right now, including talking about the book. Give me a little bit more background on the inspiration for this. It came up with the daughters. That's one thing to dad you ought to, and you actually did it. Explain the inspiration for writing the book and documenting all these stories.
Well, Genesis of it came from the daughters. I've had a great life. I know it started out a little slow, but the way I've handled most of these problems or little issues is with humor, and so I try to inject humor wherever I can find it, and it kind of relaxes me, and I hopefully relaxes somebody else when they see the wheelchair and first time meeting me and such. So that's worked out pretty well for me. And as I said, we've just been blessed. I went through high school as wanted to be an athlete, of course. And you don't see a lot of wheelchair football players on the high school field. So I thought about golf. I've got a big handicap in the golf course. Those are some of the, but I was able to work for the athletic director, and I got a letter and the numbers for my letter jacket and joined the Letterman's Club. I'm happy about that, and went to college and wasn't sure what I wanted to be. Clearly, the limitations of the wheelchair were going to scope down the opportunities for doing this or that. I thought about being a lawyer, and I thought, boy, you know, I am just not a good loser. If I'm real competitive, and if I ended up losing a case that was important to me, then I'd be a sourpuss for the next 2 weeks.
Yep, so I understand that.
I knew my limitations there, and I went into radio and TV with a psychology minor, and I got a degree, and started working at a radio station for 4 years at a country station. And it was a great time. I think I mentioned in the book, I briefly mentioned it. I'd go out and I'd been asked to MC a show for Waylon Jennings. And so I went out and told a few jokes to soften up the crowd a little bit. It was 750 people at a high school gymnasium, and nobody's laughing. And I tell you, you don't know loneliness until you're out on a stage by yourself, and none of your material's working, and in front of 750 people.
Yes.
So
frightening.
So I figured out it's the wheelchair. These people see me on or hear me on the radio noon to six days a week. And I thought, it's the wheelchair, and you're not supposed to laugh at a guy in a wheelchair, okay? So I got went to the bookstore. It's hard to find wheelchair jokes, but went to the bookstore and found a truly tasteless joke book, which, trust me, they were pretty tasteless. But I did manage to get a couple of wheelchair jokes out of there. Next time I went out, it was for Dolly Parton, and went out to the crowd and said, hi, we've got a great show for you tonight. Probably shocked to see me in a wheelchair. The voice you listen to 6 hours a day, 6 days a week. And I was shocked too. The And then I told a couple of wheelchair jokes, and they laughed at that. And then everything else in my repertoire of sorry jokes worked. And we got off stage and did the same thing for Barbara Fairchild and I think Dave Dudley was one. It was fun. Once you got used to how to make people laugh. And so I told stories like that, through college, some of the things that went on, 40 miles an hour in a wheelchair, which was stupid, but some of those things. And my daughter said, "Dad, you got to write some of these things down or someplace. So, cause we'll forget them. And, time goes by and stuff." And I said, "Well, all right." In fact, they bought me for Christmas one year, I believe it was, they bought me a software on writing a book, and it would give leading questions in the software that you would answer, and then they'd put it together. And I don't know, it didn't feel comfortable. So I just started writing on my own on Word and put the thing together. And it's a short book. It's really not long at all. But it pretty well tells from where the girls, my daughters, came from. And I have a son, too, they're all grown now. And my wife had two boys. So it pretty well put everything together and how we got to where we're at and some of the funny things that happened along the way. And it's just put it in book form so it'd be easy to grab if they ever wanted to know about Grandpa Bob.
And they can go back and look up particular chapters. And it's a very easy read. It's a fun read. The book is called It's Been a Pretty Good Ride. You'll find the book at authorreputationpress.com, the usual places for the book. Bob Harshbarger, our guest. That's Harsh. Barger. If you're going to Google to look for the book, it's been a pretty good ride. Bob, with us on the program. Information, of course, on our website, thisweekinamerica.us. Part of this whole radio thing, besides emceeing, they get you out into the public doing a lot of silly contests and things like that. And I know you had like an ostrich race at one time that was a near-death experience. Talk about the ostrich race, because this is classic, and it's, I'm glad now you can look back on it with laughter.
Well, yeah. And when you're young and just out of college and, at least I didn't think about, oh my, what could happen here?
Oh, yes. Yes.
It's one of those things where I just out of college, working the first radio job and I'm getting my show ready and back then, we don't do it now. I know, in my later radio years, we didn't do it. We did all computer and this and that. But back then you were, be like 72, something like that. You've got records and you're putting the records. You have two record players on there in the studio. And of course your microphone and the board and you're queuing up records. Well, I brought in a stack of records that I was going to play that day, at the country station in Danville, Illinois. The program director had the morning show from 6 till noon. So as I come in the studio, I hear him saying on the phone, "Yeah," and it was Bob Benson on the radio, by the way. He told me Harshbarger would never work. Your radio name has got to be something else. And I said, "Well, it was one of my grandfather's names, and it's Benson. So how about Benson?" He said, "Yeah, it's fine." So I'm coming in the studio, and I hear him talking on the phone, and he says, "Okay, well, Benson will take care of that." And put my records down. He finished his phone call. I said, "What am I going to take care of?" He says, "There's an ostrich race in Georgetown Fairgrounds, and Saturday, you got to be there at 2:00. I said, "Ostrich race? Have you noticed anything odd about me?" He says, "No, you can handle it." So I showed up at 2:00 and Saturday. And the other DJs in town were there. It was going to be a competition among the DJs. And the DJ in the middle next to me on the outside, they had to clean his cart out, if you know what I mean, before grabbed a seat in it. I transferred from the wheelchair into the ostrich cart. The guy is part of the promoter. He he says, okay, here are the reins. Hold on to these really tightly. And let me tell you that an ostrich can go from 0 to 60 in about 3 steps. So you need to hold on tight. And I'm starting to think, oh my, what could go wrong here?
Exactly.
And there's no helmet or anything like that. You're just in the... And then they gave me a broom. And I said, okay, other than the obvious, what am I using this for? Well, you see, the ostriches race on fear. And they act and react on fear. So when you get to the corner down there to make a left turn, you hold this broom up to the right side of the ostrich's face, and it scares him. And so he'll turn left then to get away from the broom. Well, okay, good. I think we're set. And he said, now when I get this, set this gun off, they're going to take off. I said, okay, all right. So we're the three of us ready to go. And Rich, I still am in touch with Rich today. Rich was the DJ next to me on the left side. And he's in Montana now, I believe. But we had dinner together at in Danville, Illinois, about a year ago. And we on Facebook keep tabs with each other.
Yes.
Rich is on the inside from the other station. And he shot that gun off. And he's right. That ostrich was just like unbelievable speed. And the first thing I did was jettison the broom and hang on and just pray that this ostrich knows what to do when he gets to the curve, because I'm sure they've done this before. And he did. We got to the curve. I'm on the outside. My ostrich doesn't make a 90-degree turn, but they're only on two legs. So he makes a 45, 50, 60-degree turn to the left, and, of course, that cuts Rich off. And all I hear as I go around that corner is, ah! And I won that heat, is what it was called. And the way they stop them is at the end of the race, on the finish line, they have the whole crew, the fair crew and everybody else, jumping up and down, screaming and yelling and waving their arms. And that scares the ostrich, and so they then stop after they cross the finish line. Had to do it again that night. Had a little more fear in me that night, knowing what we were doing, but managed to win that night again. And I've got a trophy. I don't know if you can see it or not, but over my shoulder here.
I can see that.
I brought
that
out for the interview.
Okay.
That shoulder, that trophy. It was about 2 foot tall, something
that's
like
a
that.
Nice
big
one.
Gold cup on a. On a wooden background with a plaque.
I like that.
Bob
Normally you get like a little certificate or something, so it was almost worth risking your life to have an actual trophy.
I mean,
something neat
When you look back, it's been quite a way to go at the funeral for him to say, how'd he die? Well, it was an ostrich race. But
he won. He won. Here's the trophy right here. Yes, that was all worth it. So many stories like that in Bob's book. It's a delightful book. It's been a pretty good ride. Bob Harshbarger, our guest on the program, author of ReputationPress.com. You'll find the book and other places as well. We'll give you information on the book as we go through the program. I mentioned in the beginning, and when you graduated from college, you went back out a master's in social work. Talk about this transition into the Veterans Administration and doing social work.
Well, you know, as I said, my major was radio and TV, and then I had a minor. I had a real interest in psychology as well, and what some of the therapies that are out there. And so I got my first job and worked 4 years in radio, and we had just begun to start a family. And you probably know as well as anybody, radio is not the, at least local radio is not the, one of the higher paying jobs that you can get in the community. It's fun, but that's part of your salary.
Exactly,
the fact that you have a good time usually and you do it. And I wasn't into the fame so much. That's what the Benson helped instead of Bob Harshbarger for stuff like that. But it's just fun to do and to produce things for other people or make them laugh or know that they're enjoying a particular song or give some public service announcements here and there. It's just, I enjoyed it a lot. But I wasn't making much money, frankly. And I hate to be super conservative guy, but I like to have enough money to put food on the table and raise a family.
So reasonable, yes.
I went out to the local VA and said to the social work department, I had a minor in psychology. Was there anything I could do in social work? And the chief was a great guy. The chief said, you know, but we need an associate right now. And if you'd be willing to take an associate jobs with the promise that you would go back and get your master's, then I'll give you that job. So I said, you got it. And I quit the radio station after 4 years went to school back at the U of I for the master's program, and went there Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. Went to the VA as a social work associate, and got my master's degree, and then was converted over for full-time clinical social worker, and worked there 31 years. And what an honor! What an honor to serve these men and women that that are protecting our country. And I just can't say enough about them. And again, it makes me feel good to do something for somebody else. And I was able to do that frequently. I got not only I was social work in the medical unit for about 4 years. Interesting story in the medical unit. I'm coming back to my office after seeing somebody, and one of the doctors, who's a real outspoken and kind of little pushy, nice guy, but he said, oh, Bob. I said, yeah, hi, doc. He says, I'm just getting ready to do an autopsy. You want to come in and watch? Ah, boy, you know, doc, I'm good. I'm going to go back to my office and no. You come and watch. This is a great opportunity for you.
Wow.
So, all right. I cut up a frog in high school, but I don't know if this is... So went into the morgue, and boy, did the full autopsy, put on the gown, and the I won't go into a lot of detail
in
case anybody's
lunchtime. Yes.
But it was quite an experience. I saw the full thing, and actually I learned a lot from it as well. He pointed out different things, so that was good. But then I moved to extended care, for about 4 years after that. And then I worked in psychiatry for 4 years. And then I finished up my, 20 years in admissions and outpatient, social work and all the clinics, and the admission area. And that was kind of neat. I enjoyed that probably the most of my experience, because you saw somebody new about every day, or you'd see a repeat, but that's fine too. And different problems, a different set of problems. And one guy came in, and the doctor called me down to see him, give you an idea. And I said, sure, I'll be right down. Of course, this was at 4:30. The guy had driven himself in, and he's blind, legally blind. And I said, gosh, Mr. I don't know, Smith, Jones, something. I can't let you go home. I'm sorry, but I got to get somebody to come pick you up or something. And he says, oh, I'm going to go home. And I said, well, long story short, and a lot of negotiations, I put him up as a lodger overnight and found somebody to come pick him in the car up the next day. And it's not just legally blind, because he could see fine straight ahead, but you can be legally blind by virtue of your visual field.
Yes.
So if you take a center vision of your eye and you look out 10 degrees one side and 10 degrees the other, right or left, that's 20 degrees. If you've got less than 20 degrees visual field, you're legally blind, and he was. And that worked out. But yeah, it was a good experience. I worked part-time on the weekends then at an AM station in town, and enjoyed that, but it was, again, just weekends. And then station manager asked me once in Steak and Shake, hey, Bob, would you be willing to come on the morning show with another guy, great guy, Scott Eisenhower, do the morning show for us? So talked it over with the wife and agreed to do that. And we were on for 4 years, again, 4 years seems to be key for me. We were on for 4 years, and it was a good time. We were number one in Danville, and 1 year we were number one in Danville and Champaign, a college town.
Way to go,
so
yes.
It was fun. Enjoyed that experience a lot. But they were going to change directions and talk radio and stuff, and I asked if I'd be willing to do the morning show on the AM. And boy, getting up at 3:30 every morning
gets old after four years.
Yeah, it does. And my wife was a little less than thrilled. She's a teacher, and I said, "Yeah, but look at all you're getting done, honey, at 4:30 in the morning when I take off." So it had its drawbacks, but overall, it was fun. That was a fun job. Work there 3 hours and then take off for the VA for another 8 hours. And they were long days. But
I can tell with the passion in your voice how much fun those days were, those long days. And helping people start the day on the radio and helping people through various difficulties in their life working at the hospital. Boy, the time has gone by so quickly. It has been so much fun having Bob with us on the program. The book is called It's Been a Pretty Good Ride, and as you can tell, it continues to be a good one for Bob. What was it like, I'm going to take 30 seconds here at the end, to go back and actually start the book and all these memories come back? That had to be reliving your youth, your younger days all over again.
Yeah, I don't know how you do that exactly, other than I'm not much of a reader, which is odd that I wrote this little book, but Dave Barry is who I think of when I think of writing that book,
yes.
Similar to his style. I just write down a bunch of memories, just one line, and write down as many as I can think of, and then I go back and expand on each one of them, and I left a couple out, I know, but you get the idea based on, and the pretty good ride, of course, has been a pretty good ride in a wheelchair for 73 years here and still going. God's been good.
Still going strong. Bob Harshbarger, our guest. That's Harshbarger. If you're into Googling, you can just look for the book. It's been a pretty good ride. AuthorReputationPress.com, a great place to find it. You'll find it at the usual places. And if you go to our website, thisweekinamerica.us, you can link on to get information on Bob and the book as well. Are you writing anything else? You did such a great job with this. Are you working on the second book?
Well, thanks. No, I am not. I don't know why. Maybe I'm lazy. I don't know. I am so busy. It feels like you're in retirement. I'm going to start a grief share group here soon with our church. And I've done that for about 8 years and help people work through some difficult times of grief. So that'll be kind of a rewarding experience. But there's a lot of things in my life and my wife, of course, and we visit our kids. So life is good. I'm not a quick writer.
Well, and the important thing is you're enjoying what you're doing and still reaching out and helping people, and that is the key. Bob Harshbarger has been our guest on the program. The book is It's Been a Pretty Good Ride. You'll find it again, Author Reputation Press and the usual places. Bob Harshbarger, our guest. Bob, always a pleasure having you on the program. Thank you so much for sharing some time. Congratulations on writing the book and bringing some great stories of inspiration and humor to all of us. Thank you for sharing with us on the program.
Hey, Rick, it's been good talking to you. I really appreciate the opportunity, and you take care of yourself as well.
You as well. Bob Harshbarger, our guest. The book's called It's Been a Pretty Good Ride. You'll find information on our website, thisweekinamerica.us. Back on today's program after these messages.
This Week in America is online. You can visit our website, thisweekinamerica.us. Scott Pinkerton, associate producer of This Week in America. Jay Anderson, segment producer. Ben Watson, webmaster. Otto Bechet, director of engineering and TV production. This Week in America produced and is a trademark of Blue Funk Broadcasting, LLC. For information on all of our guests and to listen to this week's show, our website again at thisweekinamerica.us. And I'm Sean Bratton, executive producer of This Week in America.